So first we need to know what is the definition of neuromuscular monitoring. Okay, so the magnitude of the neuromuscular block. So if we give any neuromuscular blocking drug, how much has that drug been able to block the nerve conduction? We can elicit by neuromuscular monitoring. Okay, so what do we do? An electrical stimulus is delivered. So that electrical stimulus is delivered to the nerve, and then we see the response, which will occur in form of muscle contraction. Okay, so the definition, whenever if you are asked this, like what is neuromuscular monitoring? Okay, so then you just have to explain it in the simple words. Okay, if you're asked in a, if anybody asks you in the Viva or in the theory, you have to start off with like this. You have to mention the definition of what is neuromuscular monitoring. Okay, so now for neuromuscular monitoring, that device which is used, okay, so it has got something which is a, there is a part of it which is a stimulator. Okay, so we'll understand that this thing, there is a stimulator. Okay, so the job of this stimulator is to deliver the current. Okay, so this stimulator has, should have some properties so that we can use it. Okay, so it should be very compact. It should be lightweight. Okay, and it should be very simple for us to operate this stimulator. Okay, so this stimulator will be delivering a current. Okay, that current will go and stimulate the nerve, and the responding muscle contraction may or may not occur depending if the block is has set or the block has not yet set. Okay, because of the muscle relaxing. So by Ohm's law, if you remember, there is some, if you remember Ohm's law from physics. So Ohm's law was what? It was something known as V is equal to I and into R, right? So V was voltage, I was current, and R was the resistance. So this is simple physics, right? For any electrical conduction. So now we know that this is I is the current and we are delivering a particular current. Now this stimulator has got a property that it will deliver a constant current, okay? So the property is that a it is a constant current stimulator, the one that we are using in the OT. Okay, so what will fluctuate if I say that this is a constant current, the I will be constant. So if we rearrange, it will become something like this, this equation. And I'm telling in this equation, this current that we are going to deliver is going to be constant. So that means the voltage and the resistance which will be there will be variable. Okay, so resistance, what is going to offer the resistance here? Resistance is going to be offered by the skin. Okay, whatever tissues are there, they are going to offer the resistance. So that resistance can vary, right? It can vary. So if the resistance varies accordingly, even the voltage, the stimulator has got that property that the voltage will change accordingly. But in the end, the output of the current will be constant. So if I decide I want to give 20 milliamperes current by in that nerve stimulator, if I select 20 milliamperes, it will give 20 milliamperes. It will sense the resistance which is offered by the skin and the tissues, and accordingly it will alter the voltage, and it will ensure that, 20 milliamperes only will get delivered, not more, not less. Okay. So the stimulator that we are using is a constant current stimulator. Okay. And it follows Ohm's law. The skin, now I told you that skin gives some amount of resistance. Okay, if I'm placing the electrodes, the skin is going to give resistance. So this resistance can be, why is this resistance occurring? Because of hair, because of skin oils. Okay, so what we can do, we can rub it off. So we have to take sanitizer, alcohol-based rub, and rub it very thoroughly. So that will help us to reduce the resistance. Okay. Then what is going to happen now? I have given a current. So I am expecting that a muscle contraction will occur. Okay, now this, I have not given any relaxant, nothing. So I will expect there will be a muscle contraction. Okay. So what is this force of this muscle contraction? With how much will it contract? Okay. So the force of the muscle contraction is going to be directly proportional to what? The number of muscle fibers that have been stimulated. So if this is adductor pollicis, okay, and I am going to, it's going to do adduction. So the force of this adduction will depend upon what this adductor pollicis muscle has got muscle fibers inside it. So if all the muscle fibers get stimulated, it will contract with more force. if less muscle fibers are stimulated, it will contract with a lesser force, right? So the number of muscle fibers getting stimulated and the force with which the contraction will occur is directly proportional to each other. So what I said was that the force of contraction is directly going to be proportional to the number of muscle fibers stimulated. Now what, so if all the muscle fibers contract, means I have delivered more current. So if I give more current, higher the current, more number of muscle fibers get stimulated and more the force of contraction, more current delivered, more muscles fibers stimulated and more the contraction, stronger the contraction. So when will I have that all the muscle fibers will be stimulated and the whole muscle will completely contract? So that current is known as the maximal current. Okay, so there is something known as maximal current. So what is maximal current? Till fibers are contracting. So all the muscle fibers are going to contract. So this is the maximal current. Now we know that when we are practicing neuromuscular monitoring in a patient who's undergoing GA, so we choose something known as supramaximal current. Okay, there's something known as, we are not going maximal, we are taking above maximal, which is supramaximal current. Okay, so what is supramaximal current? It is a little above the maximal current, is the supramaximal current. Okay, so how much is this supramaximal? Okay, so if somebody tells you how much is this, you know what is maximum, but how much is supramaximum? So first we'll understand what is threshold. So threshold current, by name only we can understand. Threshold means what? It is the least amount of current which is able to give you some muscle response. Okay, so it's the smallest amount of current which can give you a response. So how much is supramaximal? So whatever value you get, suppose the threshold is maybe 5, 7. So maybe 5 amperes or 7 amperes or some value has come. And at that value, you are getting minimal, just the response has begun of that muscle. So that is threshold. So they say supramaximal current is how much? It is 2.5 to 3 times threshold value. Now, most commonly, the nerve that we are choosing for neuromuscular monitoring is which nerve? It's the ulnar nerve. Okay. So we are choosing the ulnar nerve. So the supramaximal current for ulnar nerve is how much? So the supramaximal current, if we say the supramaximal for ulnar nerve is 30 milliampere. Okay, just a value that you can remember, that if you're doing ulnar nerve stimulation, the supramaximal current that will come is going to be 30 milliamperes. Okay, now when will you need a higher current? Okay, there are sometimes when a normal person might need 30 milliamperes for their ulnar nerve stimulation, but there are some patients who might need go above 30. So these patients are who have got edema, generalized edema, the patients who got diabetes mellitus. So they need a little higher current. Okay. Then there are sometimes in some condition that our supramaximal will be a lesser value. So supramaximal doesn't mean it's a fixed value. We will, before we start a case, we'll always estimate what the supramaximal is. So in some cases, we will get that the supramaximal number is little less than what we were expecting. So when that will occur, when the electrode that we are placing is not the gel base, it's not the surface. So surface gel base electrodes, you know, they are the ones that you see in the ECG electrodes that you see are also surface electrodes, gel base. So these needle electrodes are very close to the nerve. So because it's so close, obviously the current requirement also will be less. So in such situations, we need lesser current. Okay. Now we understood what is current. Okay, now we have to understand ki what frequency will you deliver this current. So what is, so when we are delivering any current, we are delivering how much? We are delivering, okay, 30 milliamperes, but how many times are we going to deliver? So that is the frequency. Okay, the frequency is measured in hertz. You must have heard of this term hertz. Okay, so what is the meaning of 1 hertz and 0.1 hertz? It is events per second. So if I tell you one hertz means what? There'll be one delivery of, so one cycle, one current stimulus will be given per second. And here, one current stimulus is given per 10 seconds. Obviously, 1 divided by 10 is 0.1. Okay, so if I tell you that 30 milliamperes current is going to be delivered at 1 hertz, which means every 1 second, 30 milliamperes will be delivered. If I tell you 30 milliamperes will be delivered at a frequency of 0.1 hertz, means I'm telling you that current 30 milliamperes will be given after every 10 second interval, this stimulator will keep giving it. So far, frequency concept understood? So what is the waveform of this current that we are delivering? So there are multiple waveforms. Okay. So this waveform is this. The waveform that we are getting when we use a nerve stimulator is what? It is a square wave. Okay. And it is monophasic. You only need to remember this, that this is a square wave pattern which is delivered by the stimulator and is monophasic. So if it would be biphasic, what would happen? It would be like this. The picture would look like this, okay? But this is monophasic, means it's going only in one direction, okay? And this is a square wave pattern. So have this nerve stimulator that you're using, okay? So the current which is getting delivered, what frequency it is delivered. So all these details, there'll be a small screen on your nerve stimulator. So on that, you will be able to see how much you are delivering, what frequency you are delivering, okay? So every nerve stimulator should have a visual display, okay? So that the operator, which is you, you can know. And it should also have some stimulators have got alarm in it. So if you have set 30, but the stimulator is delivering less, it is delivering more, the alarm will ring and it will alert you that there is something wrong with the device, okay? That if the current is low, there's some circuit problem, it will give an alarm. So that you should always prefer to use such kind of stimulators. Okay. Now next what comes? The stimulation pattern. Okay, that I'm giving a current. So what frequency I'm giving? How I'm giving it? So in that stimulation pattern, we have single twitch train of force. So before that, we'll understand the structure of this stimulator and then we'll understand how we'll stimulate the nerve. Okay, the different ways in which we can. What can you see? You can see that there is a nerve stimulator right in front of you. It is a stimulator without a sensor and it is only tactile or visual sensor. Now, what does this mean? The stimulator's picture. If you can see that there are these cables, red and black. So the red one, which is there, is having it's the positive electrode and the black one is the negative. Okay, so for any positive charge, we need a negative charge over here. So between the positive and the negative, a current will be developed. So now this switch is there, this stimulator, right? So I am going to attach this red one, positive one, proximally. So if this is the course of my ulnar nerve, this is the course of my nerve. So red, which is the positive electrode, will be placed proximally. Means what? If this is the course of the nerve, then the proximal part is obviously here. So I'll place it here. The black, which is there, this is the negative one. So that I will place it distally along the course of the nerve. So distally means far away. So that will be over here. Okay. Now, if in this you can see, there's a first TW is written over there, if you are able to see. So TW stands for single twitch. Okay. Then you have TOF, if you can see over TOF. So TOF is standing for train of force. You can see the third button is showing TET, which is for tetanic stimulus. And the last button, which is there, which is showing DBS, is for double burst stimulus. Okay. Here you can see this arrows and in the center milliampere is mentioned, which means I can choose the current. I can go up, I can come down. Okay. And as I told you, there should be a display. So there is a display where the current and the frequency I can see. So this over here, you can see only the stimulating part. You can't see the sensor, right? Are you seeing any other cable over here? No. So there is no sensor. So when there's a stimulator like this, where there is no sensor, that means you will see the response of the muscle visually. Okay, you will see it and you will feel it. So if I'm operating, this is the patient's hand, if I'm the anesthetist, I will feel the twitches. So that is tactile sensation and there is visual sensor. That is done by us. Okay, so this image is understood. Explaining to you here. Okay, so over here you can see that This is patient's thumb. So I am expecting adductor pollicis to do adduction of the thumb of the patient. I have placed the black distally. So along the course of the nerve is traveling like this. So I have placed it distally black, negative, and proximally red, positive. Okay. And when I pass a current between these two, positive and negative, the ulnar nerve will get stimulated. And then the muscle which is supplied by the ulnar to the ulnar nerve supplying which muscle? Adductor pollicis. So we have to see adduction. Okay. Now, there are three types of electrodes. Okay. Surface type. So surface type means what? It is like the ECG electrode which you have. It is looking like that only. It is the same. Okay. Then it is a gel based, or it may be a patch. Okay. Or it may be like a pad type. Okay. So how is this electrode ka structure? How does it look? So in the center, if you remember the electrode, this is a metallic disc which is there. Surrounding the metallic disc, you know, there is a gel. There is a jelly. Okay. And outside is the adhesive, which is going to help the electrode to stick. Okay. So these are the surface electrodes. So whenever you apply the surface electrode, you have to clean it very thoroughly. The skin you apply. If you don't clean the skin thoroughly and apply, you will get resistance, and then a conducting the resistance will increase and the correct current amount will not reach the nerve. Okay. Then you have the second type of, which is a metal electrode. So what picture you are seeing right now, this picture is of a metal ball electrode. Okay. So you can see over here that there are two metallic balls over here, right? And there is a black, which is the negative. There is a red, which is the positive charge. It's written over here, negative, positive. Okay. So this is the output. Okay. And here you have the different types of stimulation that you can provide. Okay. So single twitch and all that you can select over here. So this is metal ball electrode. Now, what is the property of this metal ball? That the electrode which is there is this. These two metal balls are the electrode. Okay. So they are in direct contact with the device. There is no cable which is connecting. Okay. It's a metallic rod which is connecting it. There is no cable. So what is the problem of this thing? Okay. That burns can happen many times with this metal ball electrode. So what you do, you hold this device. Okay. You hold this and you just place it directly. You just hold it and you touch it over here and you will get the response. There's another type of electrode, which is a needle electrode. Okay. So I'll just write it over here. There is a third type, which is the needle electrode. So needle electrode means what? So these are subcutaneously, the needles are inserted. So needle has no charge, obviously. So you will take what? So if you want to insert that needle, okay. So you will insert the needle parallel to the nerve in the subcute and try to be as close to the nerve. Okay. So you will insert. So the needles that we normally have, okay, in our hospital, it has got a hub. That hub is plastic, right? So we cannot connect our black and red cables to that plastic. It will break the circuit. So what you will do, that shaft of the needle which is there, you will clip your electrode to the needle shaft. So it will maintain the circuit. Okay. If you have special needle whose hub is also metallic, then you can directly connect your electrode to that hub. Otherwise, you're supposed to clip it to the shaft of the needle. When you're using this, there are some properties of this needle electrode. When you're using it, you do not need to use supra-maximal stimulus. So normally, when we are using surface electrodes, most of the time, hence we are using supra-maximal. But here you can use less than supra-maximal stimulus. Why? Because you are overcoming this resistance by entering in, right? So you've overcome the skin resistance. So your current requirement also goes down. Okay. When you will use this, so when the skin is very thick, okay, the extremity is very cold, patient is having chronic renal failure, patient is obese, or patient is having hypothyroidism, patient is having diabetes mellitus, okay, or patient is very edematous. So these are some conditions where you might prefer to use needle electrodes, okay? But there are some problems with the needle electrodes. Most common, needle might break. There might be chances of getting infection. Your needle might by mistake go inside the nerve. It might go intraneural and you might not even come to know. Right? Because you're going blind. So it might cause nerve damage. And because needles are invasive, they can also cause burns. Okay, and it can, so burns can occur, nerve damage can occur, breaking of the needle can occur, infections can occur. So these are the problems, okay, of needle electrodes. And sometimes what happens is that if the muscle, now this adductor is far, okay, so it's very unlikely that you are going to stimulate the muscle directly, okay. But there are times where the nerve and the muscle are located very near each other. So you might by mistake enter the muscle and you might not realize, and you might directly stimulate the muscle and you will say, okay, the response is coming. But you are ideally supposed to stimulate the nerve, not the muscle. Okay. So that is one risk. That is one issue which can occur with these electrodes. Okay.